Okay, we're just a couple of miles west of Nenakaw. We're looking off towards the northwest at multi-vortex probable wedge tornado. It's
May 3rd, 99 was a day that we suspected in the morning before dawn something big could happen. The ingredients were starting to come into place. It was fairly apparent we were going to have a lot of moisture, at least mid to upper 60s dew points at the surface, increasing winds aloft, although we did not know yet they were going to be as strong as they ended up being, and a tremendous deep layer shear, low-level shear was going to be there. The biggest question was focus. What was going to focus the development? The dry line looked like it was going to be weak, non-convergent, maybe even in pieces. And as it turns out, it was a double dry line structure. It was forecast to have south winds on both sides of the dry line. So where is the lift going to come from? As we know, the four ingredients we look for are moisture, instability, shear, and lift. Well, the moisture is going to be there, no question. Instability was probably going to be there, especially in the low levels. There is some thick cirrus moving in, which caused us concern about how strong, you know, the heating would really be. But we figured the instability would be there since the cap was weak. Shear was no problem. We knew that would be there. But the lift was the big concern. And because the lift was the big concern, the event was unfocused. Where would it form? I had actually coordinated with the forecast office in Norman, who was across the street at the time. And they had two great severe weather forecasters on duty there, Dave Floyd and Mike Brannick at the time. And I talked to those guys, and we thought there might be somewhere within this huge threat area would be a heightened threat, but where? Would it be North Texas, Central Oklahoma, Southern Kansas, Southern Nebraska? Where would it focus best? At the time, it was not clear, so we went out with highest end slight risk probabilities, but kept it a slight risk. In retrospect, that was a gross underforecast. Of course it was. We saw what happened. Violent tornadoes in Central Oklahoma. But it was something that we learned from. And we set the tables in that forecast in case the future outlooker, the 1630Z outlooker, Joe Rogash, would upgrade that. And near the end of the shift, we noticed that the VAD winds out in California and in Nevada were experiencing stronger forecast winds aloft, or sensing stronger forecast winds aloft, or stronger observed winds aloft than what was forecast. We thought, that's an ominous signal. That means this trough is actually stronger than what had been progged. The shear is going to be stronger. We briefed the day shift on that, and we briefed them, okay, we've set the table for you to upgrade because it looks like the winds are actually coming in stronger than what was progged. Models were all over the place as far as where convection would or wouldn't form and how much of it would form. Most of the models were just useless. So the day shift came in at 1630Z. They saw a little bit more information, saw a few more clues on the mesoscale, upgraded to a moderate risk. And the outlook specifically mentioned the possibility of violent tornadoes, which is a great, great call. Tremendous outlook by Joel that day. And in the 20Z outlook, upgraded to a high risk, which obviously by that time it was becoming more and more apparent it was going to be a big event.
Roger's working a midnight shift, so he's asleep, and I'm working a day shift on the mesoscale desk. And only thing I did the whole day was one mesoscale discussion for the initiation of the storms in southwest Oklahoma.
There were still some uncertainties as to exactly where storms would form. The focus was still not real tight yet. But when some of the first towers started to bubble up south to the southwest, went ahead and sent the mesoscale discussion. And it turned out to lead into the tornado watches that were issued that afternoon. After Rich wrote and sent that mesoscale discussion, he called me.
Somewhere around 3:30, I call Roger and, you know, get your butt up and get over here. Well, he has it's set in his mind the way the storms are going to go based on his overnight look at things, and then I've been looking at it during the day, and I think it looks better than what he was expecting.
So I drove in, got to the lab, walked inside. Rich's shift was finishing up. We walked into the hazardous weather test bed at the time, which was in a room adjoining the main operational area, And Chuck was in there along with Harold and a few other people. And by that time, Storm A had already started near west of Lawton. It was moving northeast across US 62 toward its eventual meeting with Chickasha. And Chuck told us, well, why don't you just go kill it? In his usual encouraging manner.
And so we finally leave Norman, and we fiddle around for a good 20 minutes toward the end of my shift and maybe till about 4:20. So we were just goofing around, and he's trying to get his wits about him after he wakes up. And, you know, he wanted to know what does the scenario look like. And finally, it's like, we just got to get out of here. So we take off, and the argument is over the navigation. He wanted to go, we went down toward Blanchard, which is, you know, southwest of Norman, and we're headed down toward Chickasha, due southwest. Well, we get to about Blanchard, somewhere in there, Roger wants to cut south. Well, you know, I want to make sure we don't get into the cores, and if these storms are rain-wrapped, HP or whatever, and it's like, we cut south, and I almost immediately blew a gasket.
Okay, we finally did our
it's like, damn you, we're driving the two sides of the triangle instead of the hypotenuse. We have a state highway that goes right where we're headed, and now why are we wasting time doing this? And then eventually we drive 5-10 minutes south. You know, we're already halfway to our turn west, and, you know, I'm having a fit. It's like, if we miss something because we took this stupid route, I said, I'm going to strangle you. We're not going to miss anything, you know, he's shooting back the whole time.
Don't worry, the hill will slow us. I know what I'm doing.
Yeah, okay, well, the hell with this.
Despite all that bickering, which was actually documented in Nancy Mathis' storm warning book, ironically enough, we came over the crest of a hill, and there it was, this wildly rotating wall cloud with condensation tendrils rotating around underneath it. A multiple vortex tornado was developing that later became the Chickasha tornado, and then there was a satellite tornado with that.
Here comes the tornado, coming around.
It's coming around the left side. We had, shit, two of them rotating around one another. Fujiwara. Holy shit. That is very, very interesting structure over there with multiple tornadoes within the same meso. The big one to the right is going to disappear. The one to the left that's wrapping around it is that. Nice cone. It's time to move soon. Come on, Rich. We got to go.
So once the tornadoes start, or we get on a good storm, we don't argue nearly as much because we tend to agree on the strategy. And that's part of the reason we chased together so long, is that we don't have drastically varying strategies in terms of what we're trying to do. Neither one of us takes the daredevil approach. You know, this notion of plowing in through the core, taking, you know, high-risk moves or ones that are highly probable to inflict damage on your vehicle. And, you know, we don't view it as a big adrenaline sport so much as kind of a mix of, yeah, it's exciting seeing storms, but there is a science element to it. And so I think that we kind of look at it the same way. And all the colorful discussions are just ways to pass a lot of time on the open road.
92, we might as well take that one.
Highway 62, we see a debris cloud.
Huge traffic jam.
Come
on, people!
Well, those were the first two of 11 tornadoes we saw that day and night. It was our most productive storm chase, tornado-wise, to that date. And the structure of the storms was tremendous.
Contrast sucks. There's not much I can do about it, but you'll have to trust me. We're just northeast of Middleburg.
We were watching the Bridge Creek Moor Wedge to the northwest from a point southwest of Blanchard. And at that time, we could see a nearly steady state mile-wide wedge, 6 miles to our northwest. We looked off to the west, 38 miles away, there was a cone tornado underneath a distant storm, and we could see it from that far. So we were seeing two tornadoes at once from two different storms. And that was just an amazing day. We ended up breaking off of Storm A because it was moving into the metro area. We didn't want to tangle with it under those circumstances. And we went out and saw multiple tornadoes with Storm B.
Okay, there's another tornado. This one we were watching a little while ago. We've had to zigzag around a lot. Definite tornado.
We still see more power effect with this storm.
Tell you what, go a teeny bit further and stop at this little sign. That'd be a great place to stop. Because it doesn't look like a train wrap, but right on the rear flank gust front, we got great motion potential. So stop right here at this thing.
It's a very strong circulation. Well, I guess we had no choice. Tornado just to the southwest of the...
Okay, we'll go back out a little wider view. Tornado northeast. Shit, I'm gonna... We'll stay here for just a minute.
We need to change film anyway.
It's evolving pretty quickly. You notice the condensation's all over the place.
Yeah.
Including the giant Mulhall beast after dark, which was bigger than the Bridge Creek Moore tornado. At one point, there were sub-vortices the size of the Spencer, South Dakota tornado in 1998, a quarter mile wide, that I had seen. There were sub-vortices rotating around a common center inside this huge wedge that we could only see parts of the condensation from in lightning flashes.
Because there's a slow, a little rise between us and it. Yeah, that looks like off to the left. There's definite tornado.
And even though it was at night, we could see one edge or the other of it from lightning flashes in the distance. And when we see one edge here, and we see the other edge over here, and we're 6 miles south of it, we knew it was a monster.